Give a round of applause to all the crew at Prove here for making this happen. So, great. So we're going to start with Steve Faktor. Yeah. I spoke with him on Friday, and I let him know early on that we're going to ask him some hard-hitting questions. And
you asked me what would be on my tombstone.
Correct. That was the last before I hung up. I said, and by the way, Steve, you know when you do go, you said, what do you mean go? I said, well, the end of your life, what is it going to stay on your tombstone? So maybe, why don't we start with that?
Yeah.
And then we can work our way back.
Well, let me pull a Kellyanne Conway on you, and I'll answer it this way. You know, I don't think how I'm remembered really matters other than the people in my immediate life who I've affected. Because realistically, very few people in life will achieve anything that endures generations. Like, Steve Jobs is already forgotten to anyone 10 years older and under. So realistically, you know, you can do all kinds of great things. You can spend all kinds of great hours at the office. You can erect buildings, which, you know, have a level of permanence that other things don't have. But for the most part, most people, their biggest impact is going to be the people they touch, the lives they touch. So ultimately focus on that, because the work itself, no one's going to remember your PowerPoints. No one's even going to remember those awesome gadgets with the little scroll wheel. So it's a little bit more philosophical than the last one, but, you know, I'm inspired by Kellyanne.
Excellent.
So I gave a really douchey answer.
No. Right. It was honest. So let's, we're all here today talking about corporate innovation. So I think it's important to ask you, Steve, let's actually...
I think they're fighting.
We're good.
Okay. Yeah, yours is good.
So let's define what corporate innovation is. we're going to come up with a definition. Steve's going to define, according to Steve,
okay,
what corporate innovation is.
Well, innovations are, I guess I need this. We'll get this right. Innovation, I think, falls into two categories in corporations. And then I'll introduce you to a third definition that I'd like to offer. So what I've seen in most companies falls into either an employee a cultural type of exercise, so falls into that. A lot of the activity is to get people behind a mission, to get the company feeling or employees in the company feeling like they're doing new things. And so the reason I say it's feeling is because there's the other side of it, which is, are you really trying to put new things in market? And the challenge with that second definition is math. And what I mean by that is, if you're someone who's working in a large corporation, math is not on your side. So let's say you come up with a $100 million idea. If you're working for a multi-billion dollar company, it's nothing. You know, and by the way, $100 million business is rare. And I know in the startup world, you know, there's a lot of businesses that are valued at $1 billion. But the reality is, even those guys aren't for real. So if you look at the actual number of $100 million businesses created, it's very small. So if you happen to come up with one inside of a corporation, you should be a hero. They should carry you out every day on their shoulders. But here's the problem. You create a $100 million business. That doesn't happen day one. That happens in year five. You risk adjust that. And now you find yourself fighting for budget with budgets that are $1 billion. So you're talking about a company that has $1 billion marketing budget, and you've come up with a $100 million idea maybe 5 years from now. And so that is the challenge in a nutshell for corporations. And you know what, I want to tease this. So let's go back to what the definition should be towards the end, because I think we'll probably go through a little process to get there.
Great. There's a lot of small business and entrepreneurs in the crowd here. For them, I think it's easy to create innovative products, and that's what they're doing day to day. But how do they build an ecosystem where the people around them is inspired as well?
when you say the people around them?
Their colleagues, their associates, the people under them.
So I actually think that they have the easy job in that respect, because if you have a smaller business, so the way I visualize it, so if you picture business as a pyramid, and you have, so let's define each angle of the pyramid, each side of the triangle. So one side is creating the product. So you're touching the world that takes the inputs that helps you create the product. The other part is selling the product. And one and the other function is servicing the product. So all three of those touch the outside world, right? So there's the triangle that represents the business, and then there are the sides that touch the world. Now imagine a giant triangle. There's a whole lot of middleware in that triangle if you're a giant corporation. So a lot of people are actually caught up in that middle, and they're floating in this abyss, trying to figure out, well, what's my strategy? What should I be doing? Where's, you know, what's our deck? We, you know, so for them, it's much harder to define a mission. But the more of your people that are touching the outsides of that triangle, that are touching that outside world, the more likely they are to be satisfied, because they have a connectivity to the product that the corporate people will never have. So I think you have a head start. That doesn't mean that you've solved the problem. Some of the best startups I've worked with and brought into corporations, they have a way of inspiring. They have a very clear mission. That doesn't mean that the strategy is always clear or well articulated, especially the engineer-driven companies. Sometimes they're so product-focused, they forget the human side. So I think the biggest piece of advice that I would give, just from having experienced it on both sides, is have someone who's human in a position of power or authority in the corporation who can reel back the activities of the company to say, yes, this is the product, but this is where we're going and why it's important to humans.
That's great. So a lot of...
You like that one? Human. I'm all for humans. I have a tattoo in the house.
So a lot of Fortune 500, Fortune 1000 companies over the past couple of years have started their own quote-unquote internal innovation departments. And that's only happened, I think, over the past 5 to 7, maybe 10 years.
Yeah.
Are they really innovating?
Are you recording this? Okay, so... All right, well, here's the truth. Most of them will be out of their jobs before their 5-year P&L comes to fruition. They'll be at their next corporate innovation job. That's the reality. Now, in terms of, are there some good things going on? There are. But the life expectancy of a typical corporate innovation group is about 2 years, and a corporate venture group about 1 year. So the reason for the innovation groups is, you know, so I've seen it from both sides. I've led multiple. And I've also spoken to, you know, countless executives, and I do this all the time for a living. The challenge is that, you know, there's a cycling that happens. So I go to these innovation conferences. Every 2 years, there's a new batch of people asking the same exact question. So if that's what's happening, then obviously something is failing, because it's the same companies represented, just a different batch of people. Someone got assigned to be, you know, the chief innovation officer or, you know, some kind of innovation role, and they're walking around looking for answers. And that should not be the case. There should be clarity. And there is a way to create that clarity, but I think very few companies know how to do that. The corporate venture groups, they have a different problem. The corporate venture groups aren't used to the same type of probabilities that regular venture companies are used to. Because those guys know that they need to bring in anywhere between, you know, up to 100 companies, one or two become a hit, they made their money. They've more than made their money. Those probabilities are not common in corporate. In corporate, you spend all of your time battling for resources, battling for executive authorization, battling for technology resources. And so by the time you are beaten up 6 to 9 months, sometimes even a year later, everyone expects this thing to succeed, whatever the thing is. So in their minds, those are the economics they're working with. So they may have two or three things that they're looking at. And by the time you've been beaten up trying to get that idea to the top of the funnel and onto someone's priority list, everyone expects it to succeed. And that starts to bleed into the logic of corporate venture groups, because they need to hit those same kind of numbers that outside groups do, but they put all kinds of filters in. They're like, oh, is it strategic? Is it this? Is it, is it a technology we're interested in? So once you install all those filters, nothing's gonna pop through. And the few that do make those filters will not get you the economics or the probability numbers that you need in order to make your numbers and make your group successful.
So, Steve, do you think there'll
be a time where corporate actually gets that and they say, this is not really our thing?
Well, I think they are. Some are starting to get it. I think it depends what part of the industry you're in. And what industry you're in, let's just say that. Because some tech companies know this, right? So if you look at Google's products, Google acquired almost everything besides search. You look at, Google Apps, you look at, all their, B2B services, you look at all of the, pretty much all of their technology has been acquired. And they've incorporated in because they know how to buy a capability and plug it into their machine. Very few companies outside of tech are very good at that kind of modularity. So I've dealt with them and they are fumbling their way through because there's cultural mismatches, there's pay mismatches, there's giant legacy systems that need to be plugged into, and they just don't have the skill or the discipline oftentimes to make that modularity work for them. So I think that acquisition could be, especially capability type acquisition, could be a driver of real innovation in companies if they develop the mechanism by which to actually execute.
But even then, it sounds like an arm's length transaction, right? Where the innovators can actually innovate without having to worry about the corporate.
Yeah. It's very hard to create an environment within a corporation that is safe from the political forces that exist in big corporations. I think you could do it, and I've seen some do okay jobs with it. The challenge is that a lot of companies, especially public companies, have to hit numbers. And so they give guidance to Wall Street, and so you're on TV all the time. You deal with this. You have to hit those numbers, and it's very hard to do real innovation, you have to be willing to hurt yourself, realistically, because you have to take lumps. And if you're not willing or able to take lumps, because chances are the thing you really need to innovate is going to compromise or threaten the business you're in some capacity. So a good example would be like Apple, if they wanted to get into streaming, right? So they, the right approach may have been to So maybe the right move would have been to say, hey, we'll buy Spotify, and before they got too big, and say, this is going to be our new model. But that would compromise the iTunes model because they were still counting on selling individual songs. So, but that's the thing. You tend not to see it, or you tend not to want to compromise the cash cow. Because once, this is a very important lesson for any kind of corporate logic. Once something is built, it will not die. It will not allow itself to die. And that applies to living things, and that applies to structures and corporations. It applies to government bodies. It applies to everything. So once it is created, it will not die unless you really put an effort towards killing it. And so it's very hard. People start to defend their budgets. People start to, have clout within the organization. They have political weight, and other people, other executives don't want to take them on. So you start to grind to a halt because of all this overhead that develops.
So that's a good point, Steve. So how do there's a lot of executives in the, I'm not gonna single them out, but there's a lot of innovation chief officers here in the crowd. What advice do you have for them in order to sort of either bypass some of those hurdles or make their job easier, is to actually focus on innovation versus fighting the machine?
Yeah.
Run. No, just fight the going, run. No, I'm kidding. I think the number one thing is know why you're doing the job. You know, what is it that you're trying to accomplish? What is an organizational goal that you can help achieve? Because it's very hard to hit materiality. It's very hard, especially in big companies. So what you can do is you can hit relative materiality. So that means you can solve a problem that is material at a certain budget level or a certain product line or a certain business segment level. But it's very hard to hit overall corporate materiality in a lot of cases. So I think pick the level is very important. The second thing is pick a big problem that is facing the company. So for me, my formula evolved over time, but eventually I got smart enough to know that the people who are about to get fired will listen the most. And so if they are threatened in some capacity, then they will work with you. They will give you resources. They will cooperate. They will be your best business partners and advocates. Because and if you can solve a business problem that turns around, you know, you have to find places with upside. People without upside don't listen. So if you go into a corporation where everything's going hunky-dory and you've got a great idea, opportunistic innovation fails most of the time. It just does. Because the way people think, you know, if you think about it, if I told you, give me $10,000, that $10,000 has a 50% chance of making you $200,000, or you can lose the whole thing. 50-50. I bet you most of you wouldn't give me the $10,000, right? Now, what if I change it and I said 75% chance you'll get the $200,000, 25% chance you lose everything? Still think you wouldn't give me the money. So I think that people operate in a way that is very defensive, and there's an element of self-selection that happens in corporations. So know thyself and know why the people who you deal with are there. There's a reason they've chosen corporate, and it's not that they're bad people. It's not that they're, you know, that you should judge them harshly, but they want the safety. They want the predictability. They want an environment that, you know, they're not at constant exposure to the forces of the marketplace. And so large corporations do that, but they also prevent you from challenging the marketplace oftentimes.
So that's interesting, Steve. I mean, so what you're saying, correct me if I'm wrong, is that going back to my original question, can corporations truly 100% innovate? And it sounds like based on those constraints, they really can't.
No, I think they can. And I think we need to kind of bring this up a level just for a second. You know, if you look at what's happening in the larger marketplace, I might get the dates a little bit off, but in 1955, the Fortune 500 was 32% of GDP. Today, the Fortune 500 is 72% of GDP. 72% of our economy is driven by 500 companies, and 50% of GDP is driven by 100 companies. So when we talk about threats to big companies, we talk about it. But if you look at the reality, yes, there are, you know, Coke versus Pepsi. There may be some, you know, jousting there. There may be jousting between the telco providers. But if you look at it, barring obstructions by government or other forces, things are coagulating very, very quickly. So threats may not be so threatening in real terms. Because the other statistic I'll offer into this mix is 87% of startups by dollar value, it might even be higher now, are acquired by large corporations. So whether you know it or not, most small, you know, most startups are working for big corporations, just not yet. And so that is the reality. Those are real numbers. So if you look at the broader threat, it may be there in passing, but in the long term, if you talk about an entity that has brand, has distribution, has knowledge of the marketplace, has capital to invest, they have a serious advantage in terms of adjusting themselves. Now, that doesn't mean they will, because a lot of times culture will screw them up and they won't be able to recover. Kodak is a perfect example. A lot of people make the mistake of saying, hey, Kodak didn't know what was coming. Kodak owned more patents in digital film than anybody. They knew exactly what was coming. They knew exactly what was going to happen. They couldn't, because of internal inertia, they couldn't bring themselves to kill off the film business or to challenge their own internal inertia.
Wow, that's fascinating.
You know, you had mentioned, you brought up Google before, Steve.
Yeah.
When we think of Google, we think of innovation. That's the first thing that comes to mind. But it's interesting that you said outside of their search, everything was an acquisition.
Pretty much.
How much of that is
Google
Plus?
A great brand,
right? Google Plus. Right. Is the challenge there,
right.
but I am following you. I think on Google Plus.
All right. I won't hold it against you.
No. So how much of it is really good Google branding and building that brand equity versus Google is actually innovating on a daily basis?
You know, and this goes at the broader definition of innovation. I think we look at it too narrowly. I think the way you integrate is a competitive differentiator. A lot of people make the mistake of thinking about products and services as differentiated. Products and services are the least meaningful way of differentiating the marketplace. I'll say that again. Products and services are the least meaningful thing you can do in a company because they can be copied. There's very little you can do, especially on the tech side, that someone else can't copy. If anyone who's spending time patenting technology is wasting a whole lot of time because it is not worthwhile. It can be copied. There's 500 ways to get to the same exact place you're at with your technology. So a real differentiator in an organization is actually being able to take pieces that are laying around in the marketplace and make them work for you. That's a real competitive advantage. That's something that's very hard to replicate. Because if you have a culture that can absorb things from the outside world and make it their own, that's way more powerful than some knickknack some guy in a basement coded.
But, you know, one thing you didn't mention is how about talent, how about human capital, right? I mean,
yeah.
That can't be replaced. I don't think that will ever be replaced. So
yeah.
I agree, products and services could be copied, could be outsourced, could be spun. And could probably be replicated within 30 to 45
yep.
days anywhere around the world. But talent is unique. I think talent is constant. That can never be replicated.
You're absolutely right. In fact, I would make this argument. Talent is the only thing left. Culture is the only thing left. And here, let me make my case, because it's a crazy statement to make, which I'm prone to doing anyway. If you look at, think about your lives, think about the things you own, the clothing, the furniture, the food, all the things in your life, the gadgets. What percentage of the people in your life had anything to do with making those things? Hardly any, right? Very low. Almost none. So if you think about it, most of your stuff in the first world is taken care of magically by outsourced people, by machines, by automated systems that deliver it to you. Amazon soon is going to have drones. There's going to be less and less human intervention delivering the products and services to you. And so when you think about the importance, the resulting or remaining importance of the things you do inside the walls of a business, there's less and less of it. And so the only thing that's left is the human connection. That is it. Because that's why you see all of these companies building jungle gyms in their offices. That's why they're all talking about employee engagement. That's why they're all talking about all of these things. Because they know the truth. They know that their employees will check out in an instant. Because they'll go on Facebook, they'll go on, not on Google Plus, But they'll go online and they'll surf, they'll read articles, they'll do whatever, and they'll pretend like it's for work. It's like, oh, this is this Inc. article, it's my sixth one, but it's definitely for work, definitely for work. It's entertainment, you're entertaining yourself. But the reality is, I think it was, I'm trying to remember the company that did the survey. I think it was Gallup. So Gallup did the study and they found that only 13% of employees are engaged in their jobs, actively engaged in their jobs. Others are either indifferent or actively disengaged. Imagine that, actively disengaged. Hating your job is now a full-time job. You're actively disengaging. So if you think about that, that is what's left. And I think what makes companies particularly stupid in this point in time that we're in is they don't know how to manage for output. We still have this factory mentality where everyone shows up at a certain time. Unless you work at a call center or some very time sensitive, or you know, you have to open the store, most people don't need to be on the train at 9 a.m. It's ridiculous. Why do we still have a rush hour? It's idiotic. And so no one knows how to manage for output. No one knows how to say, we need these three things from you this week, and then do whatever you want. But I think the fear is, and you know, the fear is letting go of legacy behavior. Because once we do, we'll realize we don't need so many people working. And that's a whole other economic discussion, which we may not have time for here.
So do you think that's going to change? Do you think the 9 to 5, the workforce, the traffic jam by the Midtown Tunnel and sitting by the Grand Central Station for a week and a half till you get home, do you think in 10, 15 years that's going to go away?
You know, it's actually happening already. You see the you know, slow bleed of certain functions. It happens with job functions before it happens to whole jobs that are starting to exit, you know, things you don't have to do anymore. And they're slowly starting to shift out of people's, lives. And then someone will leave and those functions will get pushed over to that same person. And then you just don't rehire. So it's a much more subtle change. People think there's going to be this giant sweeping wave of firings. There may or may not be, but I think more realistically, you're going to see, you know, a function go here, a function go there, and suddenly a person's now at 50% capacity. When their colleague retires or leaves or whatever, you just don't rehire and you consolidate two roles. So I think it's more likely to happen that way than it will any other way. So you will see a thinning of traffic. Because now there's one person riding to work as opposed to two who were doing that job or parts of that job.
I think you know, I've always thought that that we would come to this place where everything is pretty much outsourced, like we spoke about before. Everything could be copied and pasted, and there's not that much real value in products and services anymore. It's really about the talent. Do you think corporations are going to start acquiring companies for the talent and then just shutting down the product?
I see that happening now. I mean, there's a whole spate of acqui-hiring happening for a while, and I don't know, I haven't heard the term in a while. Maybe there's a politically correct thing for it now, who knows. But you can hashtag me or something, or mm-hmm. protest. But the idea is that, I actually think that is going to happen. I think that We're probably seeing it already. I mean, there's a lot of companies that are bought that are never integrated, and you want the people more than the product.
Great. So we're gonna open it up for some Q&A for Steve. And there's a lot of Israelis in the room. So for everyone who's not Israeli, just know that, you know, interrupting everyone is completely normal. So don't get discouraged.
Yes, I'm first. Steve, you had said that society is going to go full robot in 10 to 20 years. So what does that mean for companies that rely on human capital to differentiate themselves? So now you've got robots replacing humans. So what happens with innovation then?
I actually think robots are a temporary state. I think we're going full AI. So robots are an interim step. But, I think you still will rely on people and culture, just fewer of them. And you know, I think we're getting to a point in society, and we're witnessing now with the election and other indicators, that realistically, there's only jobs for people with B pluses or higher from pretty good schools. I mean, that's just the reality now. And so when I hear, you know, and believe me, there are stupid ideas on all sides, but when I hear Bernie Sanders say, hey, we need to send everyone to college, I'm like, no, that doesn't solve it. If this was 1955, great idea. 1965, still good idea. But now, I think the number is 50%+ of people who are graduating go into jobs that don't require a degree. So the degree is not the solution. This is a structural challenge.
Thank you. Mark Cuban recently said, and I'm going to paraphrase, that the next industry that's going to be replaced by bots is programming. So what would you say to him if he were to say that to you now?
It's already happened once before. There was, in the 80s, there was a huge a pull of programmers. So there was a thing where everyone's becoming a programmer. They would take a 1 month course, and suddenly they're programming. They're just sitting at their terminals and they're coding. All those people got replaced because the software itself, the code base, took care of all of the stuff that they were doing. And it'll keep happening again and again until that layer is completely automated and modular, and we won't even know it's software anymore. You know, so I don't think we'll have a bunch. I don't think we'll have a bunch. Let me give you an analogy that everyone here can relate to. I think in 40 to 50 years, we will look back at the time where millions of people sat hunched over laptops making PowerPoints as the biggest joke in the world. It'll be the most ridiculous period in our history. It'll be like you explaining to your kid, oh yeah, we used to get into a car, drive to a strip mall to pick up a box that had a movie on it and put it in this machine. And at the end, we'd get penalized because we forgot to rewind this box when we drove it back. You try to explain that to a 10-year-old, they'll look at you like you're a mental patient. And so this era will look exactly as ridiculous, 50 years from now, guarantee it.
Thank you for doing this. It's Naveen from Crowd Raising.
I saw you in the elevator.
I know.
We go way back.
So yeah. Way back. In this future that you're talking about, how important is a marketplace that establishes trust if the human capital is distributed?
Can you give me a little bit more context there?
You're saying companies are going to be disrupted. There's going to be AI. There's going to be robots. There's going to be process that goes out the window.
Yeah.
For the 25 people that are working, right?
They'll be really important. We want to make sure we keep them alive.
So 25 people in tech, 25 people in agriculture.
Yeah.
Is there a place for a horizontal marketplace that says, hey, I'm Naveen, I know X, Y, Z, come hire me at this price?
Yeah. I think to the extent that we're able to take care of the population, because right now we have a mismatch. We have a mismatch between the number of people on Earth and the number of jobs, good jobs, to be done on Earth. So we're going to have to deal with that mismatch probably over the next 50 to 100 years. And so eventually populations do adjust because birth rates start to go down when you know there's less opportunity, or when people are healthier and there's a higher probability that your kids will live, you know, and there's more education. So there's a number of forces that will cause this thing to readjust. So to your question, I think to the extent that people want to work, then yes, marketplaces of trust will be important. But I think that we will have to move towards a construct where that can be the case, because right now, you know, you kind of have to work because the rules of this game say that you do.
Hi, Steve.
Hi.
I know, with AI and everything, obviously, the culture of innovation will change. So what do you think, how is it going to be in the future? Because currently, with all the project management and everything, the way it works, how do you see it's going to happen in the future?
The way it happens, I think, is the way it's already been happening in your car. So if you look at cruise control, you know, people think, well, just one day I'm going to get into my car, it's going to drive me places. No, it's slowly creeping in. Slowly they've been putting a little bit more functionality into cruise control. It's a little bit more automated. Eventually the car parks itself. And it's feature by feature kind of creeps up on you. And then before you know it, you're like, oh, I'm snacking. I'm not driving anymore. You know, like when you have a burger in your hand instead of a steering wheel, you know the process is done, right? And so, and then when you don't have to leave the house at all, then you know that the next phase is done. So I think it happens in phases, and it slowly starts to creep in. It doesn't all happen at once. So it's already happening to all of us. It is getting smarter. It's just not always evident, and it's not going to happen in these big step. And there may be a big step coming up, but you see, like, Alexa is getting smarter now with all these people talking to it, and Alexa now taking all of this input. You know, machine learning will help it deliver a lot more services and be a lot more smart in how it does it. And so we're feeding a global mind slowly, and the problem is that global mind is fragmented because it resides in a number of different servers and different corporations. It's sort of like cell phone networks. Perfect example. You know, we have the coverage to be covered in the basement of a dungeon, but we aren't, because we've broken up reception among four different providers. So it's the same thing that's happening with AI and data. If we had a common provider across all of that, then this thing would be evolving so much faster.
Thank you.
I'm not recommending it, but yeah. Just saying.
Hi, Steve. John Reddick. Thanks.
Hey,
for
John.
A wonderful talk.
Thank you.
So are the schools teaching the wrong things and have the wrong motivations, both in the grade school and in the colleges? And then what, if not programming, what should people be learning to prepare themselves for the future?
Yeah, that's great. You've hit on a huge pet peeve of mine and something I've written about in my first book, A Connovation, which, by the way, you guys can get for free on my website, because it's a number of years old now, but it's still really good. You know, this the education chapter, strongly recommended. The thing with education is what it needs to do is be modular. That's first and foremost. It also needs to be different. Anything you can ask Alexa to do should not be taught in school, for the most part. You know, because the physical, just the act of fetching information has been automated. There's nothing to be taught there. So I think that learning has to be modular, it has to be experiential, and it has to be critical. You know, you have to learn to be skeptical and critical. So those three things, that's what we need to be solving for. And the idea, just as stupid as it is for a bunch of people, for millions of people, to be sitting at desks staring at laptops, it's equally stupid to have millions of kids sitting there answering questions and just, you know, flipping through textbooks and highlighting them and having a teacher ask them questions about it. I don't think that is the right way. I think there's a much more experiential modular model, and I think apprenticeships would go a long way. I think learning by doing, there's no substitute for that, and we somehow, I don't know when this happened, but we escaped that model, and I think it's a great one.
Great. Okay, we're gonna get one more question.
I wanted to ask you about the sort of the timing of innovation. It seems like when you're doing very, very well, you don't think about innovating as much as you should, and then when you're being disrupted, you don't have the wherewithal, the resources, it's almost too late. Do you advocate, is there a secret sauce in terms of, should you, when you're doing well, always be putting aside capital, be innovating for acquisitions or innovation teams or other?
Yeah, that's a great question. A lot of it is human psychology, as you can imagine. You know, even our entire economy, even Keynesian economics, is predicated on that, and it doesn't work because we never save during the good times, and then we're like, oh, but the government's got to spend during the bad times. So which is it? You know, like, are we Keynesian or are we just stupid? Because you can't pick one side of the equation, not the other. So the same thing happens in corporations. It's very hard, and I wish there was an easy answer to your question. There really isn't. It's very hard to get people to put themselves at risk, especially at large corporations. Because the minute you stand out, the minute you take on a project that has a low probability, if you don't have the kind of environment where risk is rewarded within the organization, it's very tough. And I can't be the person to tell someone to risk their job to in order to take those kinds of risks. Now, I think that's something the organization has to take upon themselves, but the way we've done public structured public companies, we don't do that anymore. But the good news is a lot of companies are sitting on piles of cash, piles of it. So they have the resources to deploy for innovation. They don't. And so we have to ask ourselves, well, why don't they? And so, yeah, maybe there's a tax reason or whatever, but if tax is your dominant means for making that decision, you're not going to be that innovative even if you do deploy those resources. That's my two cents. So I wish there was a better answer, an easier one, but it's a tough one.
There's one more? Or,
yeah.
We have two more. I want to squeeze a question in, and then we have one more. So I run a digital marketing firm. We're based in New York, and I find that when people come into the office, they say, "Ari, wow, the energy is really great. Like I feel it. Thank God our output is really good as well. The clients are happy." But I also spend a lot of my time, not focused on bringing in new business or managing the team, but just building that culture and that energy. And the energy, I feel it's infectious and it's working, but I'm also spending about 80% of my time creating that energy. What's your advice in terms of my time allocation?
To some extent, a very strong mission solves a lot of the people problem. Because when people feel like they're working towards a purpose, and to the extent that you can, embed that purpose in them, and you have to have the right people, and you have to have the right, message to them. But assuming that you do, I think that purpose will take care of a lot, not all, of those organizational and motivational type challenges. So I think it's having people understand why they're doing something. And that's really the time that's best spent in organization, telling someone why this needs to be done, even at the lowest levels, because that at least gives them a connectivity to the bigger picture. And so, in small companies like yours, it's probably a lot easier. But as that triangle that I talked about earlier starts to get bigger, there are more and more people that are lost in the abyss. And I would say that even the managers aren't necessarily equipped to explain why something needs to be done. And that's a problem.
So it's creating context and creating that constant narrative so
yes.
people know what they're doing.
Absolutely. You said it better than I did. So.
Where, if anywhere, do social good, public health, institutional reform, sustainability, etc., fit into corporate innovation?
It's a good question. It's interesting. I think the way a lot of it is done now is often very cosmetic, where it looks like you're doing something, but if you look at the materiality of what you're really doing, it's for show, it's not for real. And even startups, I wrote a piece a while back for Forbes or something about should your business be charitable? And so I think that there's a lot of misguided notions on the startup side as well. So a good example is Tom's Shoes. Tom's Shoes it's a buy one, get one, but you're dumping shoes onto a market that's a relatively cheap good that they could produce themselves. Instead, you're crippling their ability to produce it. So how does that make any sense? So it's the illusion of doing good. So if you're willing to operate at a level of stupidity that is around here, and not dig just a tiny bit deeper and ask that question, well, is this a good thing? Then you can think that you're doing good. So I think that I'm a big proponent of stakeholder value rather than shareholder value, and not enough companies view the world this way. And there's been a misconception that yes, the company should only serve shareholders. I don't think that's the case. So there's actually a really good innovation in this regard. There's a new stock market, a competing stock market that's forming. It was started by a guy, I think it was Eric Ries, who's a prominent startup guy. I could be wrong, but I'm like 96% sure. Give me some slack. But he's starting a competing stock market where companies that are listed actually get preferential, basically companies that achieve common good get preferential benefits as opposed to companies that don't. So I think that's one mechanism by which it can be done. And I think just the stakeholder orientation, it's very hard to do, but I think people now have the technology to organize themselves to be able to monitor and expose when those things are happening. So I think there's a level of leverage that's starting to creep in. So hopefully we take advantage of that leverage in order to expose situations where things aren't going well and to, you know, push back. And so at least the customer will be represented.
Great. Okay. I think we have time for one more question.
All right.
So at the very beginning, you said that there were some examples of corporate innovation and corporate venture that were good examples. And I'd be interested to hear, I don't know if you want to name specific names or maybe general industries. You then said Google, which to me is, they started as a startup. So
right,
I feel like it's very different from corporate innovation. And then on the flip side, the fact that 87% of startups will be acquired by corporations, does that mean instead that maybe instead of having corporate innovation groups and corporate venture, that the M&A group should be more innovative because it becomes more about being good at post-merger integration?
Yeah. So typically M&A groups don't have tentacles deep into the organization. They're finance-oriented. They're not ops-oriented in most cases. So I don't know that they're the right channel to do that. But to your question, there are companies that do this well. I really do believe that smart acquisition and smart partnership is the way to solve this, to truly innovate. But I think you also need to know what it is you're trying to be and achieve in the marketplace. So the thing that I'm finding a shortage of, generally speaking, is that vision, right? So there are companies that are constantly hiring outside strategists. They're constantly brainstorming. They're constantly whatever. And so it's very hard to drive forward and identify the pieces that you're missing in order to get there if you don't know where there is. Where's there? And so so I think that sometimes there's a rush lyric called if you choose not to decide, you still have made a choice. So there's a lot of companies that are choosing not to decide. Now, which companies are doing this well? I think GE's culture has been mentioned, and there's certainly tons of case studies. Now they're very industrial, so it's a very different thing than consumer goods companies. Where consumer goods companies are good is in cranking out product. They're terrible at doing new business models. They're terrible at challenging themselves to innovate in ways other than product, which I think is the least innovative way. Like, how many permutations of sugar and corn do you need in a cereal aisle? You know, but you've probably got 250 of them at least at Walmart. Anyway, so I think there are a few. Cisco has done it well for a spell, then less well in recent history. Oracle, I think the tech space, unfortunately, because of their mentality, because of their modularity, and because the nature of finding capabilities in the marketplace is so easy, and because so many startups are tech oriented, that I think they're probably best at doing this. I think pharma companies are getting better at it because they're, you know, they have a model, they're distributors. Right, so they're tied into all the health plans, they're tied into all the doctors, they're tied into everybody. So they're really just a giant distribution machine. So anything they take in from the biotech world, they can push out through their channel. So those are the best ones because they have natural channels of distribution and natural integration points. I have a podcast where I'm going to be covering a lot of these themes called The McFuture, so you should check it out. And you can go to ideafactory.com to subscribe, ideafaktory.com. So you can find me there and you can subscribe.
Steve Faktor.
All right,
everyone, round of applause for Steve.